Thank you very much for coming. See if this will work. If I turned it on. Okay. Gotta love technology. So I'm just gonna have to hit the enter button a bunch. This seminar is going to be on taking podcasting into the video space with live events, particularly with Google Hangouts and Google Hangouts On Air. I'm gonna stand over here so I don't block that. Use the keyboard. My name is Krystal O'Connor, and not to spend too much time on it, but a little bit about me. I come from a tech background. I used to work in the web hosting industry, so I work with bloggers, e-commerce, and so forth. And currently, I work for a company called Libsyn, which is based out of the Bloomfield Shadyside area, downtown Pittsburgh. We are a podcast hosting company, and I'm one of the tech nerds over there. I'm also a recurring guest on Libsyn's podcast, The Feed. And I've appeared on Podcasters Roundtable, and I currently host Libsyn Live, which is a monthly Google Hangout On Air, which is what we're going to be talking about today. So what exactly is a Google Hangout On Air? Well, I kind of like to start with asking you, who all here has a blog? Okay, good. Anybody have a podcast? Audio or video?
Video.
Audio or video? Audio. Okay. How many of you have ever done a Google Hangout or Hangout On Air? Awesome. Okay, hated it. Okay, that counts. Hangout On Air or just a general Hangout?
Both.
Okay, good. We're in good company. For those who aren't familiar, Google Hangouts is a way to generate and produce live video shows. It's done through Google Plus. It also can be syndicated out to YouTube, and it can go out to a blog page. But it's a really good way of getting up to 10 participants onto one video one time and do everything live. So why do a video as a podcast? Well, I reached out to one of my buddies, Ray Ortega. He's the host of Podcasters Roundtable. And he makes a few points. He uses Google Hangouts On Air because they're a great way to gather people together in one spot live. He likes the event page integration. It allows you to schedule a hangout and put out there, hey, audience, I'm going to be doing a show live at this time on this date, and they can get it on their calendar so you know that they really want to come see you. It also provides you some really nice controls over the audio and video settings. You get to really control who gets to talk and when, who is seen on the large picture and when, and so forth. And if you've never done live video before and you want to get started, Google Hangouts On Air is a fantastic way to get started. Minimal equipment required. We're going to talk about that. I also reached out to my friend Rem. Rem hosts the show Sci-Fi Movie Podcast. Now, he doesn't use the show, he doesn't use Google Hangouts as his daily driver for his show. His entire show is not based on live video. It's an audio show. You can find it on iTunes. But every once in a while, he will supplement his show with a Google Hangout. He says that a Hangout would be very handy if the goal is to share information that needs to be seen. So screen sharing, or if you have a video you want to share with your audience, all of that can be very easily done with Google Hangouts On Air. Why do videos, podcasts for Libsyn Live? Well, we use Google Hangouts On Air strictly for Libsyn Live. There's nothing else that we use Google Hangouts On Air. The reason is because even though we already had an audio podcast called Feed, we really wanted a way to connect with not just our users, but podcasters at large, and talk about some of the technical facets of podcasting, which is really difficult sometimes if you can't show an RSS feed on screen. You can't show the Libsyn interface or submitting a show to Stitcher on an audio show. So being able to screen share through Google Hangouts On Air gave me the ability as a technician to get down down into the nuts and bolts of podcasting and really show people how to use it. It also gives the ability to really engage with the podcasting community. I'm able to enable what is called a Q&A plugin, which I'll show you in a little bit. That Q&A plugin allows attendees to ask questions, and I can actually pinpoint that question and answer the question. And when you go back to watch the video later on, maybe you didn't get to see it live and you want to watch it later, you can see all the questions that were asked, click on it, and be taken straight to that spot in the video where that question was addressed. It's a really neat feature. So here I show a little bit of how you can get a Google Hangout on Air to many different places. One of the misconceptions, which used to be true and is no longer true, is that Google Hangouts on Air is strictly for Google Plus. If you're not on Google Plus, you're screwed. You can't watch it, you can't participate, you're done. That's not true. If you are running a Google Hangout on Air, it starts at Google Plus for you as the producer, but anyone who wants to watch can watch. They can watch from YouTube with or without an account, or you can put it onto your blog page. Also, once you're done, you can actually obtain the content and edit it as an edited video or even as an edited audio and syndicate out to iTunes. So for Lips and Live, I actually put it out to an audio feed in iTunes. I put it out to a video feed in iTunes. You can see we also put it out on YouTube. Here it is on Google Plus. And over here is where I actually use multiple webcams in order to show off displays from devices so that I can have multiple webcams and almost control it like a video studio. So if you're thinking about using live video and you have a blog or you have a podcast, particularly an audio podcast, why on earth would you want to use video? Well, the question really becomes, do you want this to be a show driver or do you want it to be a supplement to your show? So if you're going to use it as a show driver, every time you do an episode, you would do it using Google Hangouts and then go from there. Are you looking to build engagement during the time of recording? Maybe you do have a large following already and you want to be able to engage with them during the show. Oh, hey, chat room, what about this? And actually talk about what the chat room is saying during the show, kind of Leo Laporte style. That might be a show driver, so every episode is going to start with Google Hangouts on Air. Or you might choose to use it as a supplement. So maybe you're going to do a holiday special, or maybe you're an NFL show and you want to do a Hangout on Air for the Super Bowl. All of your audience gets together and you commentary and you talk about the Super Bowl during the show live. That would be a supplement to your show. Your workflow when you're using Google Hangouts on Air as the episode will always start at Google Hangouts on Air. That's where you're going to actually show yourself, show your face, show your screen, show whatever it is you want to show to your audience. And all of that gets recorded and passed out to YouTube, at which point you can distribute from YouTube or you can download it and distribute to an audio feed or video feed. So we're going to talk a little bit about hardware. Now this is going to be mostly about Hangouts on Air, but I don't know necessarily where some of you are, so I did want to take a moment and just talk about the hardware. And this can translate both for Google Hangouts on Air and even audio and video podcasts. But the first thing, if you're doing a video podcast, Hangouts on Air, otherwise is lighting. You may sound great, but you're video, you're live, and they want to see your shining face. So you need to be able to be seen. Don't shine a light right on your face. Don't put it right here, because that can white you out. It makes it hard for you to see the person on screen. So instead, take a light and bounce it off of a wall. Literally take the light and shine it onto the wall. That will create a softer dynamic, making it a little easier to see. You can also take a light and put it up against the ceiling, so the light will bounce off of the ceiling. This works great, particularly if you have a white ceiling. It'll bounce the light down. It softens the light. If you're familiar with photography, it's similar to the concept of a bounce flash, where it bounces the flash off of something else so that you don't get that red eye effect. It's the same idea, so don't put a harsh light right on you. If you have a well-lit room, great. I'm not so lucky. My office is wood-paneled, and I have no windows. So, yeah, my lighting sucks. Next up is the camera. If you're doing a live video, in almost all cases, you can actually get away with a very nice webcam for $100 or less. Some computers these days, tablets and smartphones, they come with cameras. But if you want a good production, you can actually get a Logitech C10, which is this guy right here. And if you promise to give it back, I can send it around the room. But this will record in 1080p. It is USB, so it'll plug into your laptop or your desktop. And it gives out a pretty good quality video. It does use a Carl Zeiss lens. And right now on Amazon, it's running for $95. Another option is their newer model, which is the C920. And that's this one here. A little bit better optics. But the nice part to this, and why I actually bought it, and why it's the most recommended for Google Hangouts On Air right now, is it allows for a shoe connection for a tripod. So if you look at the tripods back there, or if you see me afterwards, there is a shoe. It's just a little piece with a little screw in it, and it fits into the tripod, and then this can sit right on top. So when I'm actually displaying an iPad to someone, I will actually use this as my second camera during the Hangout and plop it right on top of a tripod so it doesn't move. So that's why I like this one. If you need to use a tripod, you want the C920. That is on Amazon for about $99.99 right now. Now this is a topic that we could talk about for an entire day, not just an hour. So I'm going to try to keep this one short and sweet. But whether you're doing audio or video, your people need to hear you, otherwise it's not a very fun show, right? Well, there are multiple different types of microphones available, so if you go looking for your first microphone for your show, you're going to see dynamic, you're going to see condenser, you're going to see cardioid, and you're going to be like, what does all that mean? Basically, a dynamic microphone and a condenser microphone are just different ways of creating the sound. Dynamic microphones are very resistant to moisture, and they're on the cheaper level, so they're really popular with musicians. Whereas a condenser microphone tends to put out a better quality, but they also tend to be a little bit more expensive. Now, you might also hear the term cardioid or pattern. So when you're talking about a pattern, you see here, this is actually a cardioid image. And what this shows is that the audio is going to be picked up from this side over here. It's going to be ignored from here. It literally tries to shut down the audio from there. So it's trying to pick up the audio from your mouth instead of what's coming in over here, what's coming in over here. One of the more popular dynamic microphones is the Shure PG58, which I don't have. So I brought the poor man's version. It's the PG48. It's the same thing. It's a little beat up. But this will work for most cases, but if you notice on the bottom, it's three-pronged, so it does require that you plug it into a mixer board. So if you don't have a mixer board and you don't want to splurge for one, you probably don't want this. On the other hand, this is one of the most popular microphones used in podcasting right now. It is the Audio-Technica ATR-2100. This is great for mobile podcasting. You can plug it in your iPod or your iPad if you want. It's great for Hangouts. It's great to put into a desk mount. This currently has a windscreen on it, so if you peel this back a little bit, it actually looks very similar to the Shure, but this is a condenser microphone. It connects both to a board, and it will actually connect using USB. So if you don't want a mixer, and you do have USB on your computer, you can plug this directly in and it will just work, which is really nice. You can get these for around $50. There's also a Blue microphone, the Blue Yeti Pro, which is what I use for most of my professional productions. That one usually runs for upwards of $250 to $300, but it's a very high quality condenser microphone. I have it sitting on a boom arm and shock mounts and all of that. So if you really want to go nuts, you're looking at maybe $300 for the microphone. That is also a condenser microphone. But the nice thing about that one is you can actually change the pattern. So this is a cardioid pattern, and it's going to pick up your audio here. You can also do stereo, where it's going to try to pick up audio here. So you can actually change with the Blue Yeti Pro, you can change where it's actually picking up the audio from. So you can really pinpoint what your quality needs to be. So now we're going to talk about setting up your first Google Hangouts On Air. Now I'm going to assume that you all already have Google accounts. You've logged into Google Plus at least once. You've seen or heard of YouTube at some point. If that is not you, for the sake of time, I went ahead and put together some written instructions that will walk you through creating a Google account, getting you into Google Plus, getting you into YouTube. And the key here is that if you've never done it before, you do actually have to turn on and allow your account for live events. If you don't do that, it won't actually let you stream live. So that packet will walk you through exactly how to do that, screenshots and everything. I'm going to skip out of the presentation and into a browser. I'm using somebody else's computer, so please forgive me for any mishaps that may occur here. Okay, so here is, supposedly, Google Plus. This is my own personal account. My device is now apparently ready to use. if you go under, we just need to cheerlead along a little bit. Let's go. Hey! That's looking slightly better. Actually wearing a lavalier right now. The kind gentleman back there handed me for this event. One of the most popular brands in podcasting for lavaliers is going to be Rode, R-H-O-D-E. They do actually make a single lavalier that is really good for mobile podcasting. I can't remember the model name, but it runs for about $50. But you can also go as high as many thousands when you start getting into multiple mics with the transmitters that sit on your belt and so on and so forth. But I would take a look at Rode because they do have some lower priced options for podcasters. So it's really great for that. There's some new ones that are starting to come out that'll work with iDevices as well, your iPad, your iPhone, iPod, if anybody still has those. So there are some of those out there. Okay, so did I answer that question?
Yes.
So on the left-hand side will be a menu, and we're going to go to the Hangouts option. And again, I apologize for latency here, but if you click on Hangouts On Air, there will be a button to start a Hangout On Air. Now this will be similar to starting a podcast. You need to create a title for your show and you need a description for your show, right? So we'll just call this Podcamp Google HOA 101, right? And for a description, I'm just going to say, hey all y'all, because, yeah. Now you can either start your Hangout now or most likely you're actually scheduling it for a later date. So we're going to go ahead and schedule this for later, and you can select a date. Maybe we'll do this tomorrow during Podcamp. You can set a time, 4 p.m. You can also set a duration. Now, the important thing to note about the duration is if you set your duration for a half an hour, your Hangout's not just going to suddenly shut off at a half an hour. This is strictly to give your audience an idea as to how long they need to black out their calendar so that they can come watch you. My Lips and Lies shows are almost always listed with a duration of an hour. Usually right before I find that, oh, I have too much to cover in an hour, so I'll leave a little note, hey guys, we might go a little over. It's also important to note, as you'll see later, that you can always get this on demand later. So you schedule it, somebody says, I'm going to come, and then something comes up and they can't, don't worry. They can always come back and watch it later. You can also set your audience. So if you are on Google Plus, which in order to set a panel on air, you have to be, you can say, this is for public. But you might also want to invite your circles and give them a little notification that, hey, guess what? I'm having a show. I'm having it at this time. Well, you do that by inviting your circles into your show. So you can select who's coming, or you can even enter very specific people's names to invite them specifically. So if you have a participant and you want to invite them through Google Plus, you can do that, or you can even enter their email address and invite them that way. Once you've filled everything in, you hit the share button, and this is going to go ahead and create your event page. And this is what your event page is going to look like. It's going to give your title up along the top. It will probably use your profile picture in the player window. And if you scroll down a little bit, there's some important information over here. As people RSVP for your show, you will see them under the viewers section right in here. So you'll see the people who said no, you'll see the people who said maybe, you'll see the people who said yes. You can invite more, and you can message your participants. So it's a really great way to build engagement or to continually invite people. Guests of your show can also invite people. Word of mouth in podcasting is one of the best marketing that you can get, and the same thing goes here. Next up is details, and I'm starting from the bottom again just because this is some of the most important information. You'll see who it's created by, that it is a public event, when, what the description is, but you also get these links. Now, the event link is the link to this page. So if you want your participants to land on this page, go on Twitter and post the event page link. Go on Facebook, post the event page link. Maybe you'll have participants who aren't on Google Plus or don't want to be on Google Plus, but they really like YouTube. Well, give them the YouTube link. That's this one right here. It will take them straight to a page on YouTube. They can watch it live from YouTube. They can watch it on demand from YouTube. Next up, and the text is kind of overlaid a little bit, but the third one is a video embed. So if you have your own blog page, or you have your own website, or maybe a buddy of yours has a website and they want to advertise for you, give them this code. You can embed that right on your website. Gotten used to a Mac. And now I don't know all my shortcuts. So you can see an example of a video embed right here. And it'll just look like a YouTube player. Now this is an event that we already did. This was our November show. When I schedule the December show, I'm actually going to switch this out with that embed link, and anyone can come to that website and watch live from that website. So they don't even have to be on YouTube or Google Plus. It can be anybody, and they can watch from anywhere, which is really great. There are many plugins available. Some are built in, some are third party. I mentioned the Q&A plugin earlier. You can actually enable that before you start your event by clicking on this Q&A button here, and it will highlight that icon once it's actually enabled. You enable the Q&A app, it allows your audience. Now, this only works from inside Google Plus, so it's the Google Plus audience, but it allows them to ask questions of the panelists, and then the panelists can go ahead and answer them during the show. This is how we run our Lipson Live show. It is a Q&A show, so it's really great for that. They also recently threw some of these other apps in here. Showcase is an app that if you have a video or a website you want your audience to read up on before your show takes off, you can enable the Showcase app and put that in there, and your audience will be able to see that before the show launches, so they're prepped. And lastly is the applause feature. This is kind of a silly little app that allows your audience to give you a virtual hooray at some point during the show. When you watch on demand through Google Plus, you can see where the most popular highlights of the show were by people giving you that virtual golf clap. When you're ready to start the event, you would use the start button. Now, there's a little trick here. The downside to Google Hangouts, other than the fact that it's Google, is that it's buggy because, well, it's Google, they tend to do that. So if you have a participant, somebody who wants to be on the show with you, and they go to the event page, they're not going to see every time the join button that they should see. And in my experience, you will see it maybe one out of every 10 times, which is kind of problematic. So the trick is when you actually go to start your Hangout, there's this URL up here in the URL bar. Any participant that you want on the show with you, maybe someone you're interviewing, or maybe you have a co-host that's somewhere else in the country from you, and you want them to participate in the show. This is not for viewers, this is for participants. Highlight this URL and plug it into your email off to them before the show starts. You can grab this as soon as you actually generate the event. You don't have to wait. So we're going to, if the computer cooperates, have a guest on here in a few minutes. And I actually sent her this URL 2 days ago so that she was prepped for this. So if there's one thing you walk out of this room with today, it's always grab this URL if you have a participant. I learned that the hard way. I started the show a half an hour late because of that. So let me see where we are. I think we're ready to start. So I'm going to go to my pre-scheduled Now, this is an event that I had created ahead of time. And, yep. So I'm going to go ahead and hit start. And someone is going to either love me or hate me if this thing actually kicks off. Now, if you've never done a Hangout before, it's going to ask you to install said plugin. Go ahead and do so. If you have a pop-up blocker, make sure to disable it so that everything runs smoothly. Yeah, it's going to automatically detect the browser that you're in and the operating system that you're on. So I tend to have almost every browser installed on my computer, so I've had to do this for every browser on my system. And if you already have it, it's not going to ask you. It's going to know that it's there. It's also going to say, hey, you're about to join a Google Hangout on Air, and it's going to put your beautiful face out onto the internet for everybody to see. You must agree to our terms of services. You know, legal and all that. Okay, I got it. And now you get a sneak peek at what you look like through your camera, and you can hit join. Now, you get a last-ditch option to go ahead and invite people to your show. You can go ahead and do so here. If your show is going to be explicit, make absolutely sure that you check off this box that requires guests to be 18 or older to join. If it's not explicit, don't don't check off that box. But if it is, make sure to check that off, because you don't want some 15-year-old coming into your show if it's explicit. And it's going to go ahead and open, and it's going to load all your plugins, and so on and so forth. And we'll go through some of those plugins. But first, I'm going to show Miss Elsie. Elsie, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Oh, okay. So
yay!
If you've ever attended a PodCamp before, you've probably seen this lovely lady. This is Elsie Escobar. She is Lucent's social media happiness expert. Is that how you say it?
Yes.
Okay. So Elsie is the host of Lips and the Feed. She's also a co-host with me on Lips and Live. And Elsie, can you just speak to the audience a little bit about what Google Hangouts On Air has been able to accomplish for Lips and Live and what might be able to accomplish for them?
Absolutely. I think that Lips and Live has been essential for being able to answer questions, especially technical questions, because there's a lot of, you know, updates that we have from Libsyn. There's a lot of like workflow hacks. There's a lot of specific things that you can do in Libsyn that maybe we think that are easy, you know, within the interface, but perhaps not so much for our users. So it gives the opportunity for people to get live walkthroughs through the process, ask questions, know who's behind the scenes, like knowing Krystal in terms of support and the technical questions, that's a real person that's answering that. It's really been able also to help me be able to, if somebody asks a question, not even in the live event, but maybe just on Twitter or on Facebook, I can easily refer them back to some of our past episodes and say, hey, Krystal really talked specifically about this issue in this Hangout. Check it out, and your questions will be answered. And it's helped me so much. I'm sure it's also helped Krystal to answer support questions as well, to know there's something that is on, you know, camera that is walking people through things. So I feel that if you have a live Hangout and there's something very specific that you keep getting questions about for you, yourself, for your company, for your podcast, for your blog, for services that you offer, having even just like even once a quarter being able to address something like this would really, really be beneficial for your community to bring it together.
That would be the example of supplementing your show as opposed
yeah.
to having a daily driver for your show. Elsie, do you mind hanging in there for a little bit while I walk them through some of these plugins?
No, please go ahead.
Okay. So on the left-hand side is kind of where all your options are going to be, but we're actually going to start in your settings. So I was mentioning that oftentimes I'll actually hook up multiple cameras. You see here it's using the integrated camera, but this drop down will light up if you have multiple cameras, so you can switch between those cameras. If you are using like a Blue Yeti Pro or maybe that ATR, you can switch to those microphones instead of the internal microphone. If you have different speakers you want to hear out of, you can choose that. One of the single most important bits here is this drop down here. Hangouts On Air historically has not had the best track rating for audio quality. It's kind of been really sketchy. But you can improve that dramatically by changing from voice to studio. And all of a sudden, your voice quality is going to go a lot higher than it was before. So make sure you use studio quality instead of voice quality. Voice quality is good if you're doing like a phone call or something like that. But studio quality, if you're going to put on a show and you want to get the most out of what Hangouts is going to get you audio-wise, you want to make sure that's set to studio. If you really want to get funky, you can switch left and right and all of that, but I don't usually want to get that funky. Down here, can't really see it under the start bar, but there's this little blue button, that's your save button. Over here is if you have a chat going on, your participants can do a text chat amongst each other. Now, I use this one really frequently since I'm a tech show. This allows me to share my desktop with the audience so they can see everything that I'm doing on the computer by doing the screen share. So if you do have a technical show, or even if you just have a website you want to show, you know, if you have a blog, you want to show off your blog post while you're talking about it, you can use the screen share so they can all see your browser window. And some of these, there's your showcase app. If you've enabled the Q&A, course, it says this feature is disabled because I didn't enable it for this one, but it will actually appear on the right-hand side. We don't have any questions coming in, so there's not much to see anyway. But if there were questions, you would see them on the right-hand side. You can select them, talk about the answer, and then say that it's answered. And that way, it's time-coded as to when the answer was actually given. You can take pictures of what's on the Hangout screen. Now, Cameraman is another app that's kind of important. Unfortunately, my resolution is kind of low. I'm not sure if I can. Down below broadcast settings, you can actually choose what happens to your participants as they join. So you can choose to mute them as soon as they join so that you can then control their volume later. You can also choose to only have the screen of the person who's talking be large, which is the default. So if you're in a regular Hangout, whoever's talking is who you see on the big screen. Or you can choose to show who's actually selected. And that's what's actually going to appear to the audience at large. So if you're doing something like a screen share and somebody else is talking while you're sharing the screen, you don't want somebody else who's talking to be visible because then people won't see the screen share. So you actually want to be able to show what you want to show, and that's how you do it. Oh, here it is. Broadcast the large video that I see to my audience and friends. Hopefully I can get back to the other side. There we go. I'm going to come back to that toolbox. There's also a control room. And from here, every participant, you can mute or unmute, and you can turn on or off their video. The really nice thing about the control room, though, there's a slider on the far right-hand side. Kind of like leveling your audio podcast. If you have a guest who's really loud, they're talking really close to the microphone, they're just blowing your speakers, and you have someone else who's really quiet, really soft-spoken, their microphone's all the way out here, you can turn the soft-spoken person up, and you can turn the loud person down, so you can almost do on-the-fly leveling of the audio, which, while you can always do that post-haste with your recorded content, doing it live for your live audience is kind of helpful. Now, if you go here, these three little dots here, there is an option to add apps, and if you don't do anything else, make sure that you look for this Hangout toolbox. You see in my screen, I have a lower thirds here, that's what it's called. It's the little bar that goes across the bottom side. It says Krystal O'Connor, Lipson Podcaster Support. The Hangout toolbox is what allows you to set that. So I'm going to click on my little guy icon here. And this little blue edge here, that's actually the on-off switch, so you can turn it on and off. And you see I've entered my name and I've entered my subtitle. You can choose a logo to you can choose a logo to upload a picture from your computer, and that's what shows right here. And you can also set the color of the bar. If you have a custom one that you've designed, you can use the custom overlay. Another really important tidbit, this is another one of those, if you walk out of here and remember nothing else, this is one of them. This little mirror button gets really important, and that's another one that I learned the hard way, as LC can attest to. Google Hangouts will automatically mirror your image. So oftentimes when you first start, what you see is actually a backwards version. And I didn't realize this until I was actually videoing iPods to show people, or iPads to show people how to podcast from an iPad, and my device was displayed backwards to the audience. But I didn't notice because it was correct to me. That's because Google Hangouts will mirror it. And Google Hangouts itself does not give you an option to mirror it back. The Hangout toolbox will. And you can see, just tap that button, and it'll flip-flop you whatever direction you want to go until the cows come home. So that's kind of a really important, even if you don't use a lower third. It's just being able to change how that mirror is. If you ever see any goofiness with the direction your camera is facing, that's how you fix it. Up until this point, we have not been live. We're not broadcasting. Elsie and I are just kind of talking on our own. You know, hi, how are you? Hi, Elsie. But we haven't been broadcasting. We've just been setting up our show. I oftentimes will actually get in there and get this set up a solid half an hour before the show starts. It gives me the opportunity to do a video check, audio check. You're not actually broadcasting until you hit this start broadcasting button. Now, Google says you can broadcast for up to 8 hours. My voice won't last 8 hours. But the point is that you're not really limited as to how long you want to go on average. And most podcasts average half an hour to an hour. Even if you wanted to do 2 hours, you can do that. So you hit OK. And now it's going to say, going live. And now it says, this Hangout On Air is live. So anybody out there in the Googleverse who wants to can now actually see this Hangout going on right now. They can go to YouTube and they can see this Hangout going on right now. And if I embed this video onto a web page and they went to that web page, they can see this video happening right now. Once you're actually done with your show, you say, bye, and you go to sign off, you hit the stop broadcast button, and now we're no longer broadcasting. Now the piece during the broadcast is going to go out to YouTube. YouTube's going to process it, and they're going to make an actual usable video out of it. But only the part during which you were actually broadcasting. So if you want to have an after party with your participants that nobody else sees, now's the time to do it. Elsie, before we let you go, do you have anything else you would like to share with the audience?
Just have fun at Podcamp. And make sure that you watch this video afterwards because you're going to...
We lost her. There goes Wi-Fi. If you can, use a Cat5 cable. When you're actually done and you want to sign off completely, you can just hit the Hangout button. The Hangout is over. It's going to tell you that it's going to take the video and it's going to upload it to YouTube. So really quick, we're getting close to the end here, but real quick, I do want to show you, on your YouTube channel, you will have access to a video manager. So I usually do this the next day, depending on how busy YouTube servers are, and if you've ever seen them with the buffering circle. depending on how busy they are or how long your video is and how much processing they have to do, it can take an hour or so for it to show up here, so I always come back the day later. But you go into your video manager and the video that you recorded will appear here, and if you click on the down arrow, you'll find the download MP4 option. So we'll download the video file to your local computer, Mac or PC. You can edit it, you can put titles onto it, you know, you can throw this into iMovie, or if you're using the Adobe Creative Cloud, you can throw this into Adobe Premiere Pro. Any of those programs will take the MP4 if you want to do editing, or if you just want to pass it right up to your Libsyn account, your Podbean account, what have you, and get it out to your RSS feed, you can do that. If you're using a program like Audacity or Audition, you can actually drag that video file over into Audacity or Audition, and it will create a WAV file, the audio file. It will strip the audio off of the video. Now you can do your editing to your audio just like you would a podcast, and you can save it out as an MP3 or your AAC file and upload it to, again, your Libsyn account, your Podbean account, wherever you're hosting your podcast, and send it out as an audio feed. So as I showed you a little bit earlier, I do, for Libsyn Tutor, we have an audio feed in iTunes, and we have a video feed in iTunes. You can get it on YouTube. So you pass it out to as many places as you can. One of the ways to do that is to strip out the audio. And let me just double check and see if I've missed anything here. No, I did that. So, you know, you have your audio, you have your video, you put it out to iTunes, you put it, maybe an edited copy, you upload to YouTube, what have you, promote. Even after the show is over, you have that on-demand copy. Talk about it for the next week. Come back to it a month later. Just the same as with an audio podcast or a blog post, you can bring this back up and promote it again. Particularly if it's everlasting content. Just, hey, you remember that time when we did that show? Here's the link to it. You can still get access to it. Don't stop promoting it. Questions? Comments?
If you wanted to use multiple cameras, what's the best device that you would recommend?
Don't use a USB hub.
Okay.
One of the things you'll run into, even with the USB 3 ports that most new computers have now, if you put it into, if you put both cameras, like I use two webcams, they're both USB. So if I put them both into a USB hub and then plug that into one USB port on my computer, there's not enough bandwidth for all that video to go through one port. You're going to use two webcams, use two dedicated USB ports on your computer. Otherwise, one of the going to show up. Same thing goes for microphones. Don't put them all through the same USB hub. There's just not enough bandwidth to really put all of that audio and video through. Use dedicated USB ports for all of that equipment. Go ahead.
Have you ever shot like using your phone or something, like on the go, even when you're doing video?
So the first, I think it was the second and the third episode of Hangouts that we did, the Lipson Live show, Elsie actually did it from her iPad at the Carnegie Children's Museum. She has two little ones, and she went with her husband. Her husband took the little ones, and she literally sat in the cafe with her iPad and her earbuds, and she co-hosted the show with me that way. So you can absolutely participate in a Hangout while mobile. No tomatoes for me. He told me he was going to heckle me with tomatoes.
I did not. I said I'd heckle you. I didn't say anything about tomatoes.
Any other questions?
Are there any limitations to the iPad version?
Well, you're not going to get the full Q&A. You're not going to get a lot of the plugins available if you use the app. You can get to it through a web browser, but it's so small that it's really not worth it. So if you really want to use the Q&A app, you have that one app you really want to use, you're going to want to use a full computer for it. If your audience knows that you're going mobile, if you're at a trade show, and you're kind of, hey, everybody, then go for it. But if you can sit and do it at a table, sit and do it at a table, because you're going to get a better quality. You're going to get a better quality picture, you're going to get a better quality audio, you're going to have a better quality network connection. Anybody else? Okay. Well, I believe I gave everybody my business card. I do work for Lipson, but I kind of really love podcasters and bloggers. They're some of the most awesome people I've ever met. And I'm very happy to help with any technical advice that I can possibly help with, whether you use Lipson or not. So please feel free to, that's the office number on that card. So please feel free to tweet me at KOCOTECH at CocoTech, or send me an email at that email address, and I'll be more than happy to help you with whatever endeavors you may have. And go enjoy PodCamp, like a lot, because there's some really awesome people here.